welcome to the CCFR Radio Podcast, your source for news, updates, and stories from the CCFR.
Hey, everybody. Welcome to episode 58 of the CCFR Radio Podcast. I'm your host, Rod Giltaka. Thanks for joining me again for this COVID-19 lockdown week one episode. So getting a little weird out there. But the good news is I've got an awesome podcast for you and with some really big announcements. So I'm really excited to tell you about those. Also, I've got an interview with Zak Wittamore from armalytics that has to do with the firearm reference table that was made available by the RCMP recently. I'm also going to answer some of your questions as well. I'll tell you more about that in a few minutes. All that and more right after this.
Once you lose rights, it's nearly impossible to get them back. Right now, there are politicians and bureaucrats working day and night to eliminate your ability to own and use firearms in Canada. They're talking about not allowing you to keep your firearms at home and even taking away the ones you already have. It's not a joke. It's not an exaggeration. Activism is a lot of work, and most people don't have the time. But something that you can do is support the CCFR. For $40 a year, you can be a part of the hardest working firearm organization in Canada and get $5 million worth of insurance. The CCFR lobbies government and works to improve the public image of gun owners through media and educational campaigns. Protect your own ability to own and use firearms before it's too late. Go to firearmrights.ca and click Why Join. That's firearmrights.ca.
All right, everybody, we are back. So, the big announcement. So here's the deal. I've got some good news and I've got some bad news. Now, the bad news isn't really that bad, but anyway, I'm going to call it bad news for now. So let's start with the bad news. So our national education campaign that we've been talking about for all this time and working really hard on is going to be delayed. I'm sure it's not a surprise to anybody, but it's being delayed for a number of reasons. I'm not blaming it all on the global pandemic, but the global pandemic is playing a huge part in the delay as well. So because I am accountable to you guys, because you're the ones that make all this possible, I'm going to give you some details about it so you can know exactly what's going on with your organization. So number one, so some of the stuff I just couldn't physically get done on time. So part of this, so there's a bunch of different parts of this campaign. I'm not going to explain all of them just because I do want to keep some stuff secret until we actually want to deploy the campaign for real purposes. So in fact, let me back up even further. We're not going to deploy the campaign anytime soon because it doesn't really make any difference. Most people aren't thinking about gun control right now. The government's not thinking about gun control. They got bigger problems. And besides, I'll tell you this, Bill Blair, who is an individual, has absolutely no credibility in anything that he does, in my opinion. Nobody's going to listen. He can attack gun owners, licensed gun owners, if he wants. None of them are going to listen to him anyway. So he's been on Twitter lying his butt off as usual, being called on it. You should see his Twitter feed. What a mess. It's a total disaster. I think he's a great case study for why you don't want to lie and why you want to take your responsibilities if you're in public service seriously. Because in times of when bad times comes, in times of need, you need to actually have credibility. So he's just taking a beating on Twitter. But anyway, on to more important things. Nobody's really concerned about gun control right now. They're not concerned about political issues. You know, it's almost like a new age of accountability is dawning, where people have to be accountable for themselves, both their personal security, their ability to feed their families, their ability to keep the lights on. That's all now come down to probably where it should be. People should be focused on what's really important. We're not going to deploy a national education campaign when people just don't really care about our issue. So that's probably the biggest reason. Now, some of the stuff I just couldn't physically get done in time. So I will take accountability for that because I'm big on accountability. So I promise to have this thing launched tomorrow. It's not going to happen. There's a couple of different components of it. So number one, there was a big web component. And what that web component was, I'll tell you a little bit about it. It was a full redevelopment of gundebate.ca. So gundebate.ca, you know, is a repository for information. It's a place to hold all the links. It's a place to find all this, you know, a lot of content and information and reports and all that stuff. But it just didn't really fulfill the vision that I had when I wanted to do gundebate.ca. It's not working for me. It's not a place where you can go and get totally involved. It doesn't have that appeal. Well, now it's going to. So I actually could have had gundebate.ca or this part of that, of the campaign done for tomorrow. But as I was working on it, just in the last couple of days, trying to finish off the last pieces, I was like, you know, what would be really nice to have. So I'm actually making more work for myself because I think it could be even better than it was. So, you know what? I'm going to reveal a little bit. I wasn't even going to say this, but I'm going to reveal it. There's a series of online quizzes and the whole thing is driven by a quiz. There's two quizzes, but I think there should be a third quiz because there's another aspect of what we're trying to do that people should get involved in. I think you'd be really impressed when you guys see it. It's awesome. But I want to do a third quiz. And what that puts on me is I have to write one. I have to reference it. And I also have to do multimedia content. So videos and other stuff to support the individual questions. So you're getting a little glimpse into what's going on that site when it gets released. But I want it to be even better because I actually have time to do that now. Whereas I was in a big rush before, so I'm going to do that. So you'll probably see the redeveloped gundebate.ca. I'm looking at the calendar now. I'm thinking maybe within 2 weeks, maybe even by the end of the month, depends on what my workload is like, because I've got a lot of other things that I'm going to tell you about that we're doing as well, because we're refocusing a little bit, right? Because obviously the world has changed. So the CCFR has to change with it and figure out how we're going to still move the interests of gun owners forward, even in times like this. And we have a plan. And I'm going to tell you a little bit about it in a second. So yeah, look forward to that in about 2 weeks, okay? The next aspect of it was there was some written materials. That's all I've been calling them, written materials. And basically, I'm not going to tell you too much about that because I want to save that for when we're going to actually deploy it. But we're going to call it the guide for now. So the guide was a written piece of written material, and that written material was going to actually get into the hands of about 100,000 people across Canada, both through mail, direct mail, and both to people physically handing it to them, using a boots on the ground national effort, grassroots effort, where people are actually physically putting this document in the hands of Canadians. Now, obviously, the physical part of this, which is probably, I would say, the most important, is not going to happen because we physically can't do it. So that'll be months from now if it happens. If it happens, I don't know. I'm not going to get into what the future is, what normal. We may be facing a new normal, or things will get back to close to normal. I think that they will, but it's going to be, in my estimation, 5 months. But my whole summer's blown, man. But anyway, we've got bigger problems than that. So that's not going to happen. But the guide itself is a tremendous amount of work, and I'm behind it. I'm behind on that project, totally behind. So you may see that, and we may release it anyway, just to you guys, just because it's good to have and good to share, in about a month. So I'm going to see what the workload is like, because I'm doing other things now to refocus the CCFR. But I'm going to see if I can get that out in the month. And if it comes out, it won't be in written form. I'm not going to spend the money to print it right now. That's not a responsible use of your money. But it'll be online. I don't know if you guys have ever gone to a magazine site where you physically can flip through the magazine and you can even zoom in on parts of it. Like, it's really cool. I'd like it to look like that. I haven't worked that part of it out, but that's, if you see it, that's what it'll probably look like. And now this is all going to come to a conclusion in a second. You're going to see where it's all going. Then another aspect of all this stuff, I'm not revealing the whole plan to you, but another aspect of it was advertising. So a national advertising campaign using radio, TV, and web. And I've got pricing for all that stuff, but I'm not gonna spend that money right now. The last thing on most Canadians' minds right now is, you know, whether licensed gun owners, you know, there's enough regulation, whether they're being hassled enough. Canadians have other priorities. So here's the good news. When the day comes that we go back to normal, or what our new normal is, and gun control becomes an issue at that point, all of the tools that we will have developed are sitting there waiting to be deployed, and in even a better form than they would have been had we released this thing tomorrow. And we can unleash that campaign on anyone we deem that needs to have it unleashed on, and you know, battle back whatever efforts there are to curtail, you know, our ability to own and use firearms. So all of it's going to be sitting there ready and better than it would have been in the first place. So I guess call me a glass half full person. I think it's worked out, you know, the best way that it possibly could have anyway. So that's the deal with the National Education Campaign. So look forward to seeing pieces of that coming out starting in 2 weeks and another piece or two a few weeks after that. Okay, so that's, if you want to call that bad news, that's the bad news. The good news is this. We are going to be shifting to a more content-heavy operation over the CCFR because we're going to have a lot more time. We're not going to be doing events. We're not going to be on the Hill. There's nobody on the Hill. We're not going to have to do, you know, there's a lot of things that we're not physically doing, and place and travel I won't physically have to do, and travel that Tracy Wilson won't have to do. And we're going to take this opportunity to create a lot of content and a lot of resources and tools for you guys. So on the content side, that's normally what I do. We're going to be doing a podcast every week. Now, I cannot promise you it'll be there every week because I get busy sometimes, but that's what I'm going to try to do. I have a guest today. I have a guest already for next week, and I've got another guest lined up for the week after that. So I'm going to try to do a podcast every single week for you guys, at least in the foreseeable future. In addition to that, actually, hold on before I move on. If you have ideas for guests, email them to info@firearmrights.ca, info@firearmrights.ca, and give your ideas. Staffer Steve is actually going to help me produce the podcast in that he's going to line up guests for me, and so that it's easier for me to make content, because I don't want every podcast be like this one where you guys are listening to me blab on endlessly. So unless I have big announcements, I don't want to talk that much. I am sick of hearing myself talk. So nonetheless, so look forward to the podcast. And in addition to that, which you may already know, we have uploaded, it's that time of year, we've uploaded our first episode of season one of the CCFR's Canada Downrange to the web for free. That's right. You know, I didn't make announcements since last year about it, but basically we legally were able to start doing that on the 1st of March, and I've uploaded the first episode already. So those of you that didn't have cable, those of you that didn't have the channel, Wild TV at the time, those of you that just couldn't catch it or whatever, you can watch it on your own time here on the CCFR channel, and episode one is up there right now. So that was the season premiere. Well, the inaugural premiere of the show itself. So check it out. I hope you enjoy it. I want to mention this, though. That television show, which was the first in Canadian broadcast history to focus entirely on sport shooting, that's a big deal for gun owners, you know, whether or not you understand why we did it. I've explained that many times, so I'm not going to go into that again. But that was made possible by all the people that buy a membership to the CCFR and or donate and support the CCFR as a volunteer. That's who made that show. You know, I played a role in it too, in producing it and whatever, coming up with the, you know, what to cover and all the rest of that stuff, organizing it. But it was really the members of the CCFR that made it. So if you're not a member of the CCFR and you're watching it, you can thank the members of the CCFR for doing that for you. And I'm going to thank the members just for supporting us to make that happen. So I'm going to be uploading a new episode of season one every single week. So you're going to get a podcast every week, probably on Thursdays. You're going to get an episode of Canada Downrange probably on like Tuesdays. So you'll have nonstop content to keep you busy at home if you're not allowed to go to work like a lot of people out there. So we want to make sure that we're out there. We're with you. We're all in this together, and we want to keep you entertained if you're kind of locked up in your house, not by choice. Okay, so that's the deal. Now, there's 13 episodes in season one, and that's going to take us all the way. I'm kind of looking at the calendar. That's going to take us into the first week or two in June. And then the good news after that, more good news, is that in June, that's where I'm legally allowed to upload season two. So as season one ends, season two will pick up right behind it, and we'll have a new episode of CCFR's Canada Downrange going all the way into, I believe, August or September. It'll run out, the 13 episodes of season two. So nonstop content from the CCFR all the way through. So hopefully that's exciting. Check out the first episode. It's up there now because right now it's, I don't know, 10 minutes to two, but I scheduled that upload to go live at 3 o'clock for me. So by the time you hear this, it's already been up there. And the other thing I would stress is share those episodes and share the fact that all those episodes are going to be uploaded on the CCFR channel every single week. Share that everywhere. Share it on the firearm forums, share it on Facebook, Instagram, you know, if you're on other videos in YouTube, you know, on Twitter, share it everywhere so we can get a good, you know, a good amount of viewers and let people know what's going on. You know, I wasn't really going to explain this, but what's really the reason why I really want you to share it. One of the reasons is the key reason. One of the key reasons why we made that show is to show non-gun owners what it is to be a gun owner. Show people, like, you know, how much passion and how much effort they put into creating shooting leagues and rules and drills and negotiating with clubs and getting sponsors and all this stuff to bring people together to do something that's safe and exciting and really is the meaning of a lot of our lives. Show them these episodes so you can see what real people, gun owners, are. It's really important. We're human, so we should be humanized. So anyway, really important to do that. All right. The last thing I want to talk about real quick is I wanted to answer a couple of questions. So people send me questions. I'll preface it by saying, if you're sending me questions or comments or compliments or thanking me or whatever on, you know, through Facebook or Twitter or any other social media platform or email too, I really appreciate it, right? So the reason why I maybe give you a thumbs up or won't answer you is only because I get so many of them, I just can't. I'm just a normal person and my brain is overloaded. I can barely get the amount of work done that I owe you guys, that I promised you guys, right? So that's why I'm not answering you. Not that I, you know, don't want to, okay? I'd love to do that. I just can't do it. And the real problem is, if I give you a thumbs up, the problem is sometimes I'll answer somebody's question. You'll see I did answer someone's question. That's why. I don't want to play favorites, but, you know, it was an interesting question. I want to share it with you, but, you know, I don't even like to answer questions because sometimes people will say, oh, that's awesome. He's talking now. And then they'll send me more questions. And then it makes me feel even worse by saying, oh, I'll answer your question. Like, now I'm brushing you off. So it's not that I don't care or I'm brushing you off. I just can't physically do it. All right. So, and I truly appreciate everybody and the compliments that they send me and the, just the support, the emotional support, because it's not easy work, right? I have to fight with people all day. That's the job. It kind of sucks because I don't like fighting with people in the first place. Anyways, so I want to answer a couple questions. Number one, the first question is, where did I write them down? I had here's the easiest one. Someone on YouTube said, hey, where's our Wild TV TV show? Because it only ran until the end of December last year. And your answer, I've already answered it because it's not on Wild TV anymore. It's now on the web. So you get to watch it as many times and share it with as many people as you want for free. Now, one of the other questions I got, and did I close that window? I think I did. There it is. I got a question from Damien, and he's in Toronto. And it was an interesting question, and I want to share it with you. So his question was, basically, he's at school. I think he's at school or work or something. And he's having a gun debate with somebody, and they're saying, and they came back with, all the school shootings in Canada were done by legal gun owners. And he thought that reflected badly upon him. And he didn't know how to respond. And I'm like, you know what? Those are hard questions or comments to respond to. So I'm just going to read you and then editorialize just a little bit about how I answered them. And I said, well, the idea that, you know, all these multiple victim public shooters that happen in schools, you know, or universities, whether or not they're licensed gun owners, that's probably true. And some of the other multiple victim public shootings that have happened in Canada that outside of schools were licensed gun owners too. And how many of them are there? I don't know. In total, like 11 in Canadian history. Like this is this is outlier behavior. These are outlier events. They almost never happen. When they do, they're horrible. Okay. They're spectacular. The media just makes them spectacular incidents, covers them endlessly, gives them endless coverage. But, you know, no one's ever disputed that these things are horrible and we want them to stop. Absolutely. And, you know, and the implication that we somehow don't think it's a big deal because we still want to own guns, that somehow we think that's ridiculous. I find it offensive. And you know what, if that's the way that people want to portray it, we don't need to even to have a conversation with them. So it's absurd. So anyway, so I said to Damien that that claim is probably accurate. There is on average one school shooting per decade in Canada. That's a fact on average. Even one is too many, but it's not reasonable to say that because of that, that no one can own a firearm. No one can own a gun. That's not reasonable. Guns are used hundreds of thousands of times per month legally and safely in Canada. We have incredibly strict laws in Canada around firearms. Much has been done to ensure public safety already. Let's not forget about the van attack in Toronto that killed 10 and injured 16. No one is contemplating daily record checks for people that rent vehicles, right? With just so much as a simple driver's license. So where's the outrage there? Where's the countermeasures there? So gun owners would simply like a reasonable conversation about these things. I hope that helps, is what I said. So, you know, here's the thing. The background to, or I guess the supporting ideas to that are, there's an inherent risk to being alive. That inherent risk to being alive is there's a risk that you could be killed or injured by something or someone. That risk starts to escalate when you crowd people together in urban centers, or you isolate people out in rural areas, right, where they don't have access to, where they don't have access to police services, or police services are delayed. There's inherent risk in everything. So there's inherent risk in using a motor vehicle every day. You're more likely to be killed in a vehicle than to be, you know, killed in an aircraft, and all the other facts that float around, all the statistical information that try to create some perspective in whether or not something represents undue risk. So when it comes to guns, Canadians own guns for good and sufficient reasons. They operate them 99.999989% of the time safely and legally, right? So we don't ban things for outlier events. We don't, whether it's motor vehicles or owning scissors or kitchen knives or skydiving or alcohol or cigarettes or any of the other risk factors that make it risky to be alive. So have we done more than enough to make sure that Canadians are as safe as they can be when it comes to firearms? Absolutely. We've overdone it. And if you really want to know the problem, it's very simple. Look at people caught with an unregistered, illegally obtained, an unlicensed individual with a handgun in their waistband, loaded with a round in the chamber, smuggled in from the United States, or stolen from a victim of crime, a gun owner, stolen from them, that don't do a day in jail. If you want to know what your problem is, that's your problem. And if you want to know what your problem is with multiple victim public shootings, stop polarizing society. Stop telling everyone they're racist all the time. Stop telling everyone that there's a difference between them based on their skin color. We're all in this together. So, and another thing, stop fighting racism by being racist. These are the things that put social and quit the hyperbolic political talk. These are things that put pressure on people, right? There's economic pressure on people that make them commit multiple victim public shootings. But remember, at the end of the day, this almost never happens in Canada. It almost never happens in most of the world. In the United States, they have a bit of a problem, but it's still rare if you consider the fact that they have a third of a billion people in the United States. So anyway, all that to say, I'm not advocating for everyone to just get guns freely with no rules whatsoever and just pass them out at the elementary school. I'm not advocating for that. We just want to have a real fact-based, mature discussion about firearms and just saying, well, you know what, the handful of multiple victim public shooters in Canada and Canadian history were legal gun owners, so no one can own a gun. That is not that's not a reasonable argument. It's not a valid argument. So I'm not trying to shut the conversation down. I just want to have a real one, an adult one. So anyway, hopefully that helps. And the last question that I got was, what's going on with the NFA lawsuit? So, you know, it's funny, based on what's going on right now, it's looking like a pretty petty thing to even have to talk about at this point, doesn't it? So in the shortest possible time, if you don't know the backstory, the NFA sent us a letter and they said, basically, we're the rightful owners of your logo and everything that's come from it. So basically, and I'm paraphrasing, send us all your money and all your property before 10 days or we will sue you without notice or delay. And we said, well, I don't know why you would think that we would do that. We fight people for a living, people a lot bigger than you guys. So no, we're not going to do that. In fact, we're not going to wait for you to sue us. We're going to ask a judge today to make a determination because you can't, we have to be able to run our business and we can't do that, you know, with the uncertainty of whether or not we're liable for any kind of copyright infringement. So we made sure that we were going to have this legal dispute done on our own terms rather than have it done on the NFA's terms. And then I went ahead and I issued an open letter shortly thereafter and said, hey, we're willing to talk. We don't need to go to court. We can talk this out, because the NFA had said, actually, we did this before the NFA said this, but anyway, they're like, oh, we just wanted a discussion. And it's like, well, okay, let's have a discussion. No problem. We don't want to go to court either. It's a waste of time, a waste of money. And we've got more important fights to fight rather than fight you guys over a logo that you think is yours. I'm still not sure how that's damaged them, but whatever. So I issued that open letter and I heard nothing. Now, meanwhile, the NFA have gone all over the place posting pictures of the claim itself, saying, oh, look, you know, all we wanted, we were just concerned about our logo, and the CCFR sued us, we're the victims, which of course is completely absurd. And if you just read the documents, I've uploaded all of them so you can read it for yourself. You don't have to take my word for it. You can see that that's absolutely not the truth. That's a lie, in fact, is what they call that. And then I went further, and there was a mandatory settlement conference as part of the process to go to court. And so we sent our legal counsel there with instruction to initiate a conversation so that we wouldn't have to go to court. And we told the NFA that we were willing to talk about it. And again, they just said they have not responded. They want to go all the way and then portray themselves as a victim, as if we're shutting them down and won't talk to them. So, you know, personally, I have a real problem with people that lie. I have a problem when politicians do it. I have a problem with when bureaucrats do it. I have a problem with when even our own people do it. And I also have a problem with people who are unaccountable for their actions. You know, if I screw something up or I don't make a deliverable, I'm accountable for it. And I'll take accountability for it. And accountability is not like the Trudeau definition, which is like, oh, I said it was my fault. It's like, no, I'll work harder and make sure it gets done. So, you know, when it comes to the NFA, they're going to be accountable for what they try to do to the CCFR, and more importantly, to you guys, the people that funded the CCFR. And I'll make sure that that happens. And, you know, so anyway, where it sits now is the NFA have decided, and this is 100%, they're going to have to wear this. They've decided they want to go all the way to court. So there's going to be no court for a while. So this is almost a moot point for now. But at some point, should we get to our, again, like I said, normal or new normal, and this process starts up again, that'll be decided at that time. So anyway, I don't give you guys a lot of updates on what's going on with the NFA lawsuit, because it's such a waste of time and so unnecessary and just didn't need to happen, still doesn't need to happen. But anyway, people ask, and I guess I owe them that. Okay, so hopefully that answers that question, at least for the next while, until the courts actually come back to work. Anyway, I've been talking too long. I don't like doing that, so I'm going to hang it up for now. We're going to take a break. We'll come back with Zak Wittamore, and we'll talk to you then.
Once you lose rights, it's nearly impossible to get them back. Right now, there are politicians and bureaucrats working day and night to eliminate your ability to own and use firearms in Canada. They're talking about not allowing you to keep your firearms at home and even taking away the ones you already have. It's not a joke. It's not an exaggeration. Activism is a lot of work, and most people don't have the time. But something that you can do is support the CCFR. For $40 a year, you can be a part of the hardest working firearm organization in Canada and get $5 million worth of insurance. The CCFR lobbies government and works to improve the public image of gun owners through media and educational campaigns. Protect your own ability to own and use firearms before it's too late. Go to firearmrights.ca and click Why Join. That's firearmrights.ca.
All right, on the Skype, we've got Zak Wittamore from Armalytics. How's it going, Zak?
Good. How are you, Ron?
I'm doing well, thanks. So the website, I mean, if maybe just explain it for people that that don't know what Armalytics is or the website does, and then we'll take it from there.
Sure. So the website is armalytics.ca, and right now what it is it's an online tool to explore the public version of the Canadian Firearms Reference Table. So if you log in there, or you know, you don't have to log in, you can get on there and search any firearm that's in the firearms reference table that the RCMP provided, and you get all the information that's in the PDFs, as well as a whole filtering tool, so you can filter by class, caliber, model, make, and lots more.
So now these are PDFs that the Canadian Firearms Program provided. Now, do you know how they came out? Like who predicated this release of information? Because not everybody knows, but the firearm reference table is something that the RCMP would never give the public. They would never give access to a regular gun owner. Apparently, we're supposed to guess what's in there and guess when they change things, whether they, you know, if they change the classification of a firearm. But at the same time, they'll sell it to foreign governments actually for not a lot of money. So it's weird. Do you know how we ended up getting a hold of this?
I'm not certain who actually made the request, but I do know that there was a request made. I think it was an ATIP for them to release it to the public. The process dragged on for for quite a while, and they were finally ordered to release it to the public, at which point it took them a year to do so. I think many people had their fingers crossed that there would be access to an online portal or some tool like that, but instead, in what I would say typical government fashion, they released it as a 98,000 page PDF. And the issue with that is that, you know, most people's computers cannot even open the thing. And then people who could open it in the browser, it would fail at around page 20,000. And it wasn't a good, document to actually search for anything in.
Yeah. Well, that's the malicious nature of some of these bureaucrats, right? Like, oh, you want the information? We'll give it to you in a, you know, comma separated value format, right? Have fun. So I think, just to add to what you're saying, I think the person that started this all was Kerry Mold. I had him on the podcast about it was right when the podcast started, so maybe 2 years ago. I wasn't sure if it was Kerry's thing but based on what you're saying that it was an ATIP, then that I think that's we can credit Kerry for that. And he went to battle for this thing. I think it took him 4 years. And including the privacy commissioner getting involved with suing the RCMP to get the information. Yeah. Maybe I'll have Kerry on maybe in a couple of podcasts from now, and he can give us the conclusion of that story. But yeah, based on what you're saying, I think that's where it originally came from.
Yeah. I've been kind of following this story. I really wanted to get access at the data. In my day-to-day life, I'm a data scientist, so I'm always working with data, and I always find it interesting. But when I found out it was this 98,000 page PDF, I knew it was going to be really hard for the average person to access it in a meaningful way. So my first instinct was to extract the data from this PDF, put it into a format that I could use. First off, it was just for myself. I wanted to find all the cool non-restricted guns and oddball guns and weird calibers. And once I successfully extracted the data, I figured, let's take this further and build a website that everybody can access, because I think it's important that every firearms owner can access this document. And it's updated every 2 weeks, and we will also keep it updated on the site.
So updated, what needs updating? Are you getting more information from the RCMP?
So we've already had two PDFs released. Right now, like I think somewhere around 100 to 200 firearms were added. And I haven't had a chance to actually go in and see if records that already existed have changed, but I imagine that there are changes. So the next plan for the site is to be able to track those changes and have them front and center on the website so people can see what new guns are being added and what guns have changed. You'll be able to favorite certain guns, and you'll get a notification when the information on that gun changes. And that was actually one of the suggestions that an early user gave me. So we are definitely going to implement that. And if you do sign up, you'll get that hopefully as part of maybe a monthly newsletter that tells you what's changed with the FRT, so you can stay on top of all the things that are going on.
Mm-hmm. So speaking of signing up, so if you can just go to the site and you can search guns and models and makes and all that stuff, because I went there and the site looks great. But if you want more information, then you're going to want an email address from someone. So what are you going to do with that information?
Yeah. So the email address is, it's being stored in a really secure way. We're using the latest technology on AWS. So no one has to worry about any privacy information. I take privacy very seriously myself. But we wanted to grow a user base because we do want to be able to reach out to people to keep them updated on what's happening with the changes in the firearms reference table and eventually add more tools to the site. One example is that PDF extraction is not perfect, and we do want a way to perhaps the community to help fix some of the errors that might be occurring on the site. So there is going to be a strong use case for authenticated users interacting with the firearms reference table, whether it be to have discussions about certain firearms or certain legal topics, or even just helping to fix the parsing that was done.
Yeah, and if I were to add another feature for you, like you needed suggestions from me. But one more thing that you could do is if you're getting updates somehow, I don't understand the mechanism for you to get new PDFs unless it's a policy change at the RCMP where they're saying, well, we're going to release every change to the FRT without having to be sued. But if you're getting updates and you're doing those things, you might want to send alerts to people. So, of course, the biggest example was the reclassification of the CZ-858 and the Swiss Arms rifle, where the RCMP went under the cover of night, changed the classification from non-restricted to prohibited, and there was 13,000 rifles out there, and they told no one, and just wanted to wait and sit there and wait for people to be arrested and have their lives destroyed. That was really the birth of the gun lobby back in those days, because the treachery was unimaginable. But maybe you'd be in a position to see new updates come, and you can send out advisories like, hey, there's been a change in the classification of these specific firearms, kind of thing.
Yeah, that's certainly a great idea. We could easily implement that so that any classification changes, whether or not you're subscribed to it, could be part of a newsletter, a monthly newsletter, or whatnot. And as far as ideas are concerned, I mean, our email address is info@armalytics.ca. It's on the site, and we are welcoming all suggestions, comments. I really want this to be a site that everybody wants to use. And, we need your ideas to put into place. How do you want to use it? And what do you want to see as the firearms community in Canada? So
cool.
Welcoming all suggestions.
Awesome. Now I didn't want to, spring a test on you, but can you spell armalytics for everybody?
Yes, that is A-R-A-M. I've already already made a mistake. It's A-R-M-A-L-Y-T-I-C-S.
All right, just because it's not a normal word. So yeah. Awesome. So it's armalytics.ca.
Yeah, exactly.
Perfect. Congratulations on the site. It looks great. And I think it's going to be very valuable.
Yeah, and one of the great things about it is that you can find all these interesting firearms. And so I urge people to get on there and see what you can find. If you find something interesting, we'd like to have an email because we'd like to put a featured section on the site, maybe feature a new gun every week or something that they find. There's some stuff in there that, I'm sure a lot of people did not know that you could legally own. Some really cool stuff. So there's definitely a lot of useful information in there.
Oh, so it sounds like you've got big plans for the site other than a place to go if you wanted to look up what the FRT is on a firearm.
Yeah, we want to make it interactive. And eventually, I do want to take the project further and into incorporating other possible data sets related to firearms in Canada. I'm a strong believer in data, and I think that there's an opportunity to have other sources, whether it be crime data or things like that. I think it'll really give us the edge in terms of our, fight for our rights to own firearms in this country. If we have all the data on our side and we're using fact, I think we already use fact, but the more data we have to back it up, the better.
That is a true statement. Well, that's awesome. Well, one more time, the web address is armalytics.ca, and thanks for coming on, Zach.
Thanks a lot. It was a pleasure to be here.
All right, everybody, that's going to do it for episode 58 of the CCFR Radio Podcast. I really appreciate you coming back and listening and sharing the podcast. Don't forget to share it. And when it comes to the TV show, as we upload them, don't forget to share them everywhere. Put them on you know, the gun forums and all your social media. Keep pushing that stuff around so people can get the benefit of what the CCFR members and supporters created. You know, it's one thing to create this stuff. That's what the CCFR does. It's up to you guys to make sure that we realize the benefit from it by sharing it and directing people and sitting them down at your house. Just say, hey, watch this. This is made by the CCFR. And this maybe explains why I love shooting so much. That's what these tools were meant to do. So make sure that you guys use them. Other than that, thanks to Zak Wittamore for coming on. Armalytics, pretty cool stuff. So check out his website. And last but not least, if you're not a member of the CCFR, you like what we're doing, and you can afford it in these hard times, consider becoming a member. It's $40 a year, and you get some insurance as well. But you're not really doing it for the insurance. You're not really doing it for the plastic card. You're doing it to make sure that we can continue to do the stuff that we're constantly doing for our community. So if you can do that, we greatly appreciate it. If you just want to donate something, that's great. Volunteering, well, not a lot of stuff to volunteer for now until we're clear of this whole national lockdown thing. But again, thanks for your support, and we will see you guys soon.
This is another episode of the CCFR Radio Podcast. Remember, if you don't stand up for your own ability to own and use firearms, who will? Join the CCFR or donate right now at www.firearmrights.ca.